before I tell you about the latest research in our lab, I wanted to give a background about my personal opinion where modern life sciences are going, where I think that the promises are and where I think the dangers are. Mostly in the context of high throughput, big data, and corporate life sciences, the corporate approach, rather than the individual, sort of more cottage industry, curiosity-driven small labs. Here we have a larval zebrafish that expresses a genetically encoded calcium indicator. So we can visualize neural activity in the whole brain. So this is a top-down view. Here's the front, here's the back, that's the tail, the eyes would be here. And this is a side-on view, this is a frontal view, a coronal section. And you see all the neurons being active. Blinking means active. So we can watch the combined activity in all of the neurons of a larval zebrafish. And we went further than that. We also did whole brain connectomics, where we can do the wiring diagram underlying this activity. Here is a sort of a nice rendering of the projectome of a larval zebrafish. So that's really awesome. That's absolutely spectacular. And we can even go further than that. We can, I guess all of you are worrying or wondering how this is going to get to DNA loops and chromatin remodeling. But I'll tell you, there's a clear link. So we can do all of that, but we can even go further. Look at that. There's just this flash. Wasn't this amazing? Yes. We can do this in the same animal. So we can first watch the whole brain active, even in a behaving animal, and then we can take the animal and do an EM reconstruction. This is sort of the latest technological breakthrough. And the way we do that is, with the help of Jeff Lichtman, my colleague and friend at Harvard, we can do whole brain connect EM. The challenge was to find, so the neurons that we can clearly see in the electron microscopy image, can we register them back on the live fish that was same animal was previously imaged with light microscopy. Can we register those neurons? Is this even possible? 100,000 neurons in this larval zebrafish's brain. And the next two slides just show you that we can do this. So this was the GCAM5 image that we took previously, and you see all of these neurons here. And let me go back again. Here is the EM image, and you can see they are perfectly in register. So we can go back now from the EM, find the neurons that were active previously, as shown here, and then we can do selective sparse reconstruction of a subnetwork that was active during the behavior. And we can now do the EM sparse reconstruction, which is even feasible. I mean, this is not crazy talk. This is something that is even doable. So that is really amazing and spectacular. And the big question is, now what? So this was big data science so far. Amazing technology. We have unrestricted access to all the information we could possibly want about the behavior and the neural activity and the underlying circuit diagram. And this is a somewhat uncomfortable situation because there's supposed to be a lot of promise. Yes, that if you only had that, I mean, this was for the last 50 years, sort of an idea in neuroscience. If only we could record all of this activity, then surely the answer will fall out, right? We just have to then look at the data and then we can make sense of it. We can explain the brain finally if we only have these data. And that was the problem. So we have all the data now. And now the challenge was, go ahead and explain the brain. And it turns out that's actually really, really hard. And maybe more importantly, having all these data doesn't help all that much. It's actually not that informative. It's sort of a dirty secret that once you've sequenced all the genomes and done all the connectomes and have collected all the data, all the proteomics, answers don't fall out. It's actually almost pointless. It's almost useless if you don't know exactly what you want to know and what the questions are, what it means to understand. I think this is sort of a bit of a jab against the corporate approach to science, is the industrial approach to science, is to making maps rather than trying to get an understanding. And there is really a fundamental difference between a description, a map, and an insight, an explanation. And I think that distinction between mapping and explaining gets somewhat lost. It's certainly blurry, right? It gets blurrier and blurrier. Again, the hope is once we have all the maps, that explanations will fall out, and they usually don't. And we can make this statement now because we've generated all the maps, and we are now in a position where explaining it and making sense of it, it turns out to be surprisingly hard. And that's sort of the story I want to tell you today. If it's not that, if the goal is not just making big maps and catalogs, what is it? How should we approach life sciences, biological sciences? And this is where we went back to David Marr. David Marr was a theoretical neuroscientist at MIT. He died very early of cancer, but he left a rich treasure of information. And he actually already explained or laid down the law, the rules, what it means to understand something. Yes. If you want to understand something, what do you have to do? The three levels of understanding by David Marr. And he says, any machine carrying out an information processing task must be understood at the following three levels. What I like about this is very dogmatic. There's no wiggle room, right? It must be understood at these three levels, meaning if you don't understand it at these three levels, you don't really understand it, right? So there's a reverse psychology here, yeah? And he says the first level in which you have to understand, in this case, in our case, any machine carrying out an information processing task, we replace this with the brain, huh? The brain must be understood at the following three levels, but later on I will replace the brain with something you might be interested in, for example, chromatin remodeling. So this applies, I think, to any claim of understanding in biology. So the first level of understanding is computational theory. What's the goal of the computation? Why is it appropriate and what is the logic of the strategy by which it can be carried out? I interpret this as sort of the evolutionary theory. If we go back to brains, an animal has a brain, presumably to behave, to generate behavior. What's the point of this behavior? What good does it do for the animal? Why has it evolved? Why does it exist in the first place? So there must be an evolutionary advantage, otherwise it doesn't really make sense. This is computational theory. If you want to explain a machine carrying out an information processing task, there must be a point to that. What good does it do for the animal? So you should start with that. Well, I'll talk later about the sequence. Level two is a representation and algorithm. So once we know what's the point, we should ask how can this computational theory be implemented? In particular, what is the representation for the input? And we'll talk a lot about that today. The output, and what is the algorithm for the transformation? So any machine takes in some information, does a computation and puts out an output. In the case of the brain, the input is sensory stimulation through any modality. It can be stored information from the past. It can be evolutionary information, that is, or cultural information that's implemented in the brain. That's the input. What kind of computation, what algorithmic computation do you apply? That is amazing. Pablo is actually one of the heroes of the talk today. He's online, he could partake. Any questions? Maybe I should. That's level two, right? Find out what is actually being computed, and then only at level three is the hardware implementation. Yes. Once you know what the computation is, how can the representation algorithm be realized physically? And in the past, I've given this talk with an application to brains, but this is where Jan-Michael Peters comes in. So we've discussed this just half an hour ago, but this also applies to something like gene regulation. Yes, and I'll briefly, so this is something, the slides we came up with an hour ago. So level one would be gene regulation. Why do genes have to be regulated? Why do promoters and enhancers have to meet? This is more like the evolutionary theory of gene regulation would be level one. And one of the things is that an enhancer and a promoter have to meet, yes, in order for that to work, they have to form a loop and meet here. And this is often very, very difficult when there's more than a megabase pairs in between. Yeah. So how does the cell get A and B to meet if there's a huge distance between those two? Now you have a question, a machine carrying out information, a task, a computational task, how do you bring those two together? And one algorithmic explanation, level two algorithm would be loop extrusion, that you have a machine, in this case, that forms a loop and pushes the DNA strings together through that loop until A and B meet. That's an algorithm, yes, an algorithmic explanation of how you get those two to meet. And this was, maybe not surprisingly, proposed by physicists who realized that there's a problem here. And this would be one solution. And so the algorithm is a theory that's to be tested, and people do that now. And the mechanism now, in this case, would be how does this pump actually work? How do you implement that mechanistically? And apparently this is totally unclear. But answering this question only, I think, makes sense if you know what's being pumped and why. And this only makes sense, yes, to address this question if you know what's the point, right, to bring A and B together. This is just sort of a side note, and I tip my hat to the Institute of Molecular Pathology. Sort of, this is my gene regulation slide here. So, but I think it applies to everything. And now the question about an application in neuroscience, the three levels by David Marr, is rheotaxis in larval zebrafish. Maybe one last jab against the modern sciences. Modern sciences spend a lot of time down here. I know this is certainly true for neuroscience. I think it's also true for proteomics and sequencing. If you study a hardware implementation of something, like the cortex, how does the cortex work? And you look at implementations of something where you don't know what the algorithm is, that's really, really hard. Just looking at the hardware and trying to make sense of it is actually extremely difficult. It's solving the inverse problem. Yeah? And once you know, and again, I think that's one of the problems that's certainly true in cortical physiology. If you record from all the neurons in the brain, but you have no idea what they might be doing, it's almost impossible to make sense of it. Going from here to here. Going from here to here is that easy. Once you know the algorithms, yes, seeing how they're implemented by the hardware is actually a fun and entertaining project, and this will be the end of my talk today in the context of rheotaxis in larval zebrafish. So what I'm doing now is I will tell you about one of the latest stories in my lab where we tried to apply David Marr's approach of the three levels in the context of a very interesting behavior in the larval zebrafish. And the behavior is rheotaxis, and at this moment, I would also like to encourage the audience to interrupt and ask questions. If anything is unclear, do not hesitate. So if you can make this a little bit interactive, I don't mind at all. So anything that you disagree with, you can. You see, if I had said this at the beginning, then my initial rant already launches a discussion that can last for an hour without me getting to any data. So now, that we can do afterwards, right? But now, when we get to the actual science, we can please feel free to interrupt with questions or comments. One of the first questions I usually get is, what is rheotaxis? And that's a good question because many people don't know. It's the ability of an animal to navigate with respect to flow. So rein is ancient Greek for to flow, pantare, Democrit means everything flows, and rheotaxis is navigation with respect to flow, usually the water, could also be the air, and it's called anemotaxis. So all aquatic animals do this usually. When the water is flowing, they navigate. Positive rheotaxis means you go against the flow. Negative rheotaxis, you go with the flow. Salmons do that when they migrate upriver to find the spawning grounds. So all animals do that. And the rest of the talk is about the larval zebrafish and can we answer the question of rheotaxis at all three levels. Huh? Level one, well, first of all, yes, sir. The two stars are Pablo. You've met him briefly here. Yes, he was online on Skype. He is now in Munich. He's looking for a faculty position. Iris Ostrasil was a grad student, and they were a star team. And George Lauder is a colleague of mine at Harvard in OEB who taught us a lot about the biophysics of fish swimming. So, first of all, this is the apparatus. We put a larval zebrafish in a tube, and we push water through with a plunger, and we ask, do fish, larval zebrafish, do rheotaxis, yes or no? So if they do it, positive rheotaxis would mean they swim against the flow of the water. And here is the data. It's a fish, a movie, and it starts to drift, and now it turns around and swims vigorously against the water current. The water stops, and now he's swimming randomly again. And we can plot this. This is one of the few data slides you'll see. So this is position in the tube. This is time here running on the y-axis. Here is where the flow starts. And an innate object would drift to the left, yes. But a fish doesn't drift. It actually actively swims against the flow and maintains its position within the flow. This is how you can plot this, and then you can quantify orientation and gain. Do they hold position truly? So they do it. Now maybe briefly we can stop here and say, okay, fish seem to do, they perform rheotaxis. MAR level one. Does anybody want to already tell me what would be the question? Why? How do they do that, right? What's the point for a larval zebra fish to swim against them? And then you can even go further and can say, so do they do it in an optimal way? Do they use the correct sensory input? What good does it do for the animal? And those are usually the hardest questions to answer definitively, because it's harder to do experiments, right? Those are evolutionary timescale experiments. And in order to answer question one, level one, we'd almost have to go back to India and Pakistan as on a field trip and see what are the natural conditions under which larval zebrafish evolved. It's very tempting, yes, to do that, to organize field trips, sort of harder to implement, also harder to get funded. But I still think it's an interesting question. A couple of our theories are for MAR level one is they do this because they don't want to be swept down into the big rivers where the big animals live, might get eaten. Another one is maybe like many of you who have children can relate. As long as they're babies, you don't want them to explore randomly the outside world. You want them to stay put where you where you've put them, right? And you get very nervous if they start wandering. And those are babies, so maybe it's an innate mechanism that makes sure they stay where the parents have laid the eggs, that they don't wander off. And the one robust mechanism to stay in place is to rheotaxis. So if there's a current, you just want to resist that. Another theory for MAR level one is so they have evolved in India in deltas of big rivers where there are swamps that get drained over the seasons. And if you live in a puddle, you don't want to get drained out into the swamp, right? So there's slow currents that drain you out, and then in order to prevent it, you want to resist the flow. Yes?
Do adults do rheotaxis?
We don't really know. I think they do. In zebrafish, I'm not sure it's been really tested. In other fish, goldfish and trout, they do it. It's very reliably. I think it's the idea to stay put, to not get moved passively into an environment where you might not want to be.
And if you put several of the larvae,
yeah?
Do they start swimming
behavior couples? No, really, not at that age. So they don't shoulder school at this age. And there are some interactions, social interactions, that that's a talk I'm not going to give today. It's mostly olfaction, so they like to hang out in a group, but this is triggered by olfaction. So they like the smell of their siblings, and they get sad when they don't smell it. So this is something we found. This is more a talk about fish feelings. Yes, sir. I won't get there. But the swimming behavior is usually uncoupled. Yes, so they do disturb each other. They get more, they swim more in a group, but it's, I think, just perturbations in the water. All right, MAR level one, a little unsatisfying, but that's sort of often a hallmark of MAR level one that you can't really know. MAR level two is algorithm. First, which cues is it using? What is the representation for the input? What do you think? How would you do rheotaxis if you're in a river and you get swept along by the water? How do you know that you're in a current?
Visual input.
Visual input, very good. Yes. Actually, the first one, there's a simpler one, and that's touch, right? You actually touch the wall. Yes, you have to touch the wall. And that's something we rule out. The fish are not touching the wall in our tube because they never make contact. Right? So we can see that. Vision. Yes. How would you test that?
Remove the background?
Move the background, yes. Move the background, that's right. And actually, it's very good. If you move the background, they will follow, which means that they are doing rheotaxis based on vision. It's called the optomotor response. It's been very, very well studied. We've completely cracked that all the way to MAR level 3. So they can use vision, and they use it robustly to, yes.
You see whether,
yes, whoops. I've given it away already. First of all, let's ask, how would you test whether they can do it without vision? I'm actually curious.
Blind,
make blind fish. So there are three answers to that, right? This is actually a really important experiment that we did. Is vision not just sufficient? Is it necessary? And so there are three proposed experiments. That's what I call the biologists, the geneticists, and the engineers. Propose three completely different solutions to that experimental setup. And the biologists say you blind the fish, right? It's easy to do, you can make blind fish. Geneticists would say we don't rip the eyes out, we just make a mutant that can't see. Yes, sir. And what does an engineer say?
Turn off the light.
Turn off the light. Yes, yes. It's easy. I mean, I come from physics, so for us this was easier to do. We found they can do it in darkness as well, and I'll show you the data later. So if they can do it in complete darkness without vision, what else could they use? It's not touch, it's not vision. I said it already, inner ear, but why did I say inner ear? What is the inner ear?
Well, we have lateral
line. Well, you're jumping the gun here, yes. They sense the flow with the lateral line, but let's say we don't know about this. Humans have an inner ear, right? You measure acceleration, right? They can actually initially, when they get accelerated, they can measure that or the lateral lines. Which one is it? So first, we remove, I told you that already, we make it completely dark. And we play the movie, yes. And what you can see, they swim against it in complete darkness. And these are the data you've seen already. So in black is darkness, in white is with light on. And equally well, darkness and light, they don't care. They can do rheotaxis. And here's how you see how they orient into the flow very robustly. The flow is always coming from the right. And here there is orientation, cosine, so the angle, if it's zero, then the cosine is one. So on average, they orient into the flow independent of the actuator velocity. Well, actually, they orient better when the velocity is higher, at 5 millimeters per second. And here, when it gets really fast, the flow, they maybe do a little bit worse. And here's how well can they maintain position against the flow. And that's sort of not surprising that when the water velocity gets hard, especially in darkness, they have a bit of a problem maintaining the gain, so keeping up against the flow. But they can still do it very robustly. So they can do it without the acceleration. Yes?
But can you test the same in genetically blind? Because maybe we have night vision, I don't know.
Yeah, it's a good point. Well, so maybe the best answer to that is not us, but other people have looked in cavefish, in blind cavefish, where the eye has been removed by evolution. They don't have any eyes, and they can still do it. That's probably the best idea. In terms of night vision, I mean, we know a lot about the opsins in the eye, and we know they more or less match mammalian opsins. In fact, they're blue shifted, not red shifted. So, and we are doing this in infrared. So, and we are pretty sure they can't see anything. But it is a good point. Yes. Sir. All right. Yes.
In your first experiment, you had this stripe pattern at the bottom.
Yes.
Right? So, what if it's conflicting?
Ah, yeah. No. If you give them conflicting stimuli, this is a question I usually get at the end. If I give them flow and visual that are opposing, vision usually wins. And that makes sense because zebrafish are very visual animals, so they use vision a lot for almost all behaviors. And also, when it's present, it's a much more reliable cue about which way the water is flowing than anything else. Yes, sir. This is going to become clearer over the course of my talk, that detecting flow in the absence of visual cues is actually really hard. It's actually almost impossible. Right? If you go to a homogeneous flow, that's a discussion we might have later on. It is actually impossible. You can't know that you're moving. This is usually a fun debate that where a large part of the audience say it's easy. You just measure the flow over your body. We'll talk about this in a moment. So until now, this is still a detective story. This is a total mystery. How do fish? What's the input? How can they possibly know that they're being moved? That they're in a moving body of water. And that's why the acceleration, maybe they're measuring the initial acceleration, that was a really valid proposal. How do you test that? So this is one of the experiments that I'm most proud of. So design an experiment that allows me to distinguish, to answer the question whether fish use acceleration measured by the inner ear, which they have, It's just like all of you, they have a utricle and a saccule, they can measure acceleration. Are they using that to solve the puzzle? Or do you test it?
You move the whole tube with the
wall. Wolf. No. What's your name?
Alex.
Alex, very good, yes, yes, sir. Usually the biologists would say you just take out the inner ear with a laser, right? And ask whether they can still do it or not. The problem is if you do that, they can't. They don't do it anymore, but then you really don't know. I mean, it's sort of the classic knockout experiment where you really have no idea. So what you do, this is how the experiment works usually, yes? I would say I made this PowerPoint slide. I'm very, very proud of that. It's really cool. Yes, this is my animation. And what we did, we put the whole setup in a box. We put it on a skateboard. We take the same actuator, attach it to the skateboard, and now accelerate the whole box, what Alex said, and see, do they swim against it or not? They should. If they're measuring the acceleration from the inner ear, they should now, and they wouldn't know the differences. And we can do this where we increase the acceleration up to tenfold before they actually start to care. Pablo, who was just present here, during the process of designing these experiments, once got the decimal point wrong here on the linear actuator, and he crashed the whole microscope into the wall. Right? They do respond to that. If you have the acceleration, here it's getting accelerated, and the fish just doesn't care. So they're not responding. They can sense it, they just don't care. So they're not responding to the acceleration. Now, the plot thickens. The lateral line. Many of you might not know, fish have a lateral line. They actually can sense minute changes in water flow over their skin. They can do that. They have these lateral line hair cells. So humans have them too, but they're also exclusively used in the inner ear for sensing sound, pressure waves, and for sensing acceleration with the otolith. Fish have the same hair cells that stick out into the water such that they can measure minute changes of flow. The question is this actually useful to do rheotaxis? And here's another question for you. I downloaded this image from the internet. And the question is this a person sitting in a boat, trailing the hand, or is the person sitting on the side of a river, of a brook? Yes, sir. In which case, in one case, the water would be moving this way if it's a river. If it's a boat, the boat would go in the other direction. So that's the lateral line of a larval zebrafish, yes? You have that too. You have fingers that you can stick out. The question is this useful to know which way the river is going? It's certainly useful if you're sitting on the shore. Actually, who thinks there's three possible answers? Answer A, we'll do a brief poll here in the audience. Answer A, it's a river. Answer B is a boat. Answer C is you can't say. Everybody has to raise his or her hand at least once. Who thinks it's A, it's a river? Who thinks it's B, a boat? Yeah, I see. Who thinks it's C, you can't say? That's correct. It's impossible to say. It's a frame of reference problem, right? There's actually no way you can distinguish that if that's the only information you have. So, you would need more information than that to know that you're in a river or in a boat. Namely, if you're in a river or sitting next to a river, then the rest of the world doesn't move, yes? And if you're in a boat, then the rest of the world would move. That's the difference. A boat. Well, but now here's the critical question to all of you. What if it's a boat in a river and the boat is not moving actively? It's just drifting with the river. What would this look like? Nothing. It would be like a lake. Nothing would move.
Hans Christian Hegel.
I don't really know how to... Well, we can leave this for entertainment, for comic relief yourself. We can have this guy in the pop-up. Maybe Pablo will come back online and then we can... asking questions. So if it's a boat drifting in the river, then there would be no flow whatsoever over the hand. Yes?
Actually not necessarily. True. It depends on how long the arm can reach, because by the friction between the boat and the river, it would slow down the flow in certain parts of the encounter zone.
Thank you very much. Yes. So this is so what if the river is homogeneous? Let's assume there's homogeneous flow, right? The speed of the river is big Mississippi, right? We're in the middle. you would still think that if your arm is long enough. So maybe the simple answer to your question is there is no friction between the water and the boat because the boat is drifting with the river. If the boat is drifting with the river, then the velocity of the boat is exactly that of the water around it. And then there is no friction and there is no pressure difference. And then no matter how far you reach out, it's always gonna be, there's gonna be no pressure, no friction, no flow. This is the fundamental problem that everybody has with the whole story, is they think that something like this should happen in the case of a fish drifting in a homogeneous current, when in fact it is not. And Pablo made another animation that highlights this. So if you replace the fish with a scientist, yes, and we blind the scientist, we can't see anything, and now we put him on a water tank on the back of a truck that's moving at constant velocity, then if you're inside here, there's no way in hell you can know that the truck is moving. And maybe the best example that usually convinces people, yes, I had a similar discussion with my mother, and she also had a hard time getting this. And the one thing that I think everybody understands is if you think we here, right now, are moving 1,000 miles an hour, kilometers per hour, in eastward direction because of the rotation of the Earth. So we are moving at tremendous velocity in one direction, but we don't know, and we can't know. I mean, unless we look at Coriolis forces and get really fancy about it, but usually we cannot know that we are moving. And the reason why we can't know is because everything around us is moving at the same velocity, right? If the whole system is moving at the same velocity, then you cannot know that you're moving. Nobody can, yes? Not Galileo, not Einstein. So that discussion has been had. Just a second, yes. Is one of the punchlines. This is the most important reference in the paper that we've published recently. It's a reference to Galileo, who already thought this all the way through, and it's Galileo transformation, constant velocity, and you cannot know. Einstein has reformed this a little bit, and that's what makes this whole story such a mystery, yes?
How much does hearing?
Hearing is a little more complicated because of the source is moving at a certain velocity with respect to you, you get a Doppler shift, right? Even distant galaxies. So the way you can know, I don't know, is the question, how could you know that you're in a river?
A scientist, for example, could hear the engine of the car, so he would know that the car
moves, but not in which direction, right?
Not in which direction.
Well, but the fish know which direction, they swim against it. And even if you hear an engine, doesn't mean the car is moving, could be idling. You only would know it's moving if there's a Doppler shift, right? If you actually, that's actually true. If the engine is locked to the car, you have no idea that you're moving, right? In an airplane, if you can only know you're moving if there's a sound source outside of your reference frame. And then it gets bright, it gets higher or it gets lower, right? But if the sound source is inside of your reference frame and you're moving with it, then you have no chance, none. The only chance you have, and this is sort of the point of the whole story, is if you get a cue from an outside reference frame, which for Neotax is how you would know you're in a river and not in a lake, is you reach out to the shore. You need a clue from an outside reference frame. Yeah? Either you touch the shore, you look at the shore, yes, or you get some other clue from the shore. What's the clue for us knowing that the Earth rotates? The stars, the sun and the stars, right? So we only know that we are moving because we have an outside reference frame, which is the sky. Yes, the sun, the moon, and the stars tell us that. Without that, we wouldn't know. And the same is true for the fish. Yes?
You actually do know. If you would shoot a bullet over 2 miles, you would not hit your target if you wouldn't correct for it.
Coriolis forces. Depends whether you're shooting east or west or north or south, right? Yeah. If you're shooting due east, then you wouldn't know. You agree? No? It's the Coriolis force, right? You actually have to make use of the curvature of the Earth, right? Yeah. So I think the Coriolis force gives you a clue, but it needs to be in the right direction, only if you're moving north-south, right? Yes?
I don't need absolute values, I only need the difference, like the acceleration sensory.
Acceleration would help? You mean for the Earth or for the fish?
For the fish, because I want to see where I am, so I only
yes.
Had to measure...
Acceleration would do. acceleration would be perfectly sufficient, but remember, we ruled that out. We did an experimental control with the skateboard where we could show that the fish does not respond to acceleration.
Yeah,
remember?
Could it be a combination?
Well, they don't do it.
For example, the hares can also measure the acceleration because the water starts to fluid and the fish has a mass, so it needs time to go with the water. So
yeah.
I can measure there the difference too. It's also a kind of acceleration measurement with
yes.
the hares.
With the lateral line, you mean now, right?
Yes.
The
yeah.
problem is that the lateral line also actually, if you homogeneously accelerate the water volume, then the lateral line also cannot, there's no water moving over the skin. Because the fish will get accelerated exactly with the same value as the water around it, if it has the same density, right? Then the fish gets accelerated with exactly the same value as the water around, so the hair cells sticking out won't be able to tell a difference. They only can if the fish is actually denser or lighter than the water. There's a sort of an interesting
yeah.
wrong intuition. If you have a helium balloon and you come back from a party in a car and you slam on the brakes, yes, then everybody in the car moves forward, but the helium balloon goes backwards, right? So the same is true for a fish. Acceleration would only affect the lateral line if the density of the fish is different, and it's not really. Yes.
This whole thing being dragged along is only true if the fish is perfectly still, right? Because then you would have zero friction. There's no self-movement of the fish.
What if this guy starts walking around or swimming around in the truck? Then there's a lot of friction and water and hair cell activity that's self-generated, but it has nothing to do with the flow of the river.
In this case here, there's no water flow, right? It's just like the
yes, the water's flowing. The water's flowing at 20 kilometers a second to the left. It is. There's water flow here. I can demonstrate again. Look. Flowing. The water's flowing. It is. And in a river, it would flow exactly the same way. There would be no difference. It's flowing at a constant velocity. And if you now, maybe that's the other deceptive problem that everybody has. Once I start moving, swimming in a river, it's harder to swim upriver than downriver. That's an illusion that we have because we are locked to the reference frame of the shore. It's actually not. You can't tell. If you're in a big current, it's not harder to swim against the current than with. It's exactly the same. It's the same as if you're in a train, that it's harder to walk towards the engine than towards the caboose. Or right now, that it's harder to walk eastwards than westwards, right? Because it's not true. Or in a plane, it's not true. It's not. If you swim in a lake, you have all kinds of frictions, but it's mathematically decoupled from the net flow of the water. So those two, it's the Galileo transformation. Yes? That's what Galileo realized. The flow, the constant velocity of the water is independent. You can cancel that out. So self-motion doesn't help you at all. Yes, sir. If you start swimming around now in the tank, you wouldn't know. You still wouldn't know which way the water is flowing. Right. Let's move on. So the one thing that's left, I mean, this is why this is such a fundamental problem, and this is why this actually resulted in a relatively high-level publication, because it is a really hard problem for any animal to solve, is to do rheotaxis in the dark. Because what Galileo said already should be impossible. And there are all publications from 1906 by Kennedy who said already you can't use the lateral line or relative flow measurements to do rheotaxis because it's impossible from first principles, and he was right. And that's why I think there is actually a real mystery here. Why? How can a fish do that? And the one thing that the fish has is the water flow is not homogeneous. It has a gradient in a tube. Yeah? So that's what water actually looks like. When you push it through a tube, it's not homogeneous. It looks like that. That's the tube. And this is how the water profile, the velocity profile, builds up over time. And here we have the steady state water profiles in our tube for different tube diameters. And as you see, this is centimeters here. So the largest tube we have is 4 centimeters. The smallest tube we have is only 2 centimeters wide. What you see here already in a large tube, it's mostly homogeneous. Yes? There's only these boundary layers here where there's a gradient. In a narrow tube, there's a gradient everywhere. I think that's actually not an experiment, that's just, we know already, that's the only thing left for the fish is to measure these gradients, because that's a cue from the outside world. That's a cue from the outside reference frame. So what would be the prediction here for Rio taxis? Where should they be able to do that and where not? He has to sample, yes, but in under which shallow, medium, and steep, where would you predict?
Steep,
they can do it, shallow, they can't. And another prediction is, if you look at them in a shallow tube, in a shallow gradient, in a big tube, they should only do rheotaxis where? At the edges. Only here and here, that's a prediction, right? And it's not even a very exciting prediction, because we know already, like Sherlock Holmes from First Principles, it's the only thing left. It's the only thing left. So this was a kind of a cool experiment, but it was we knew already what was going to happen. But before we get into that, there's still another question of what kind of flow does a fish actually feel when you put him in a velocity gradient like that? And it's not swimming around. Once it starts to swim, then it's clear, then flow will, the water will wash over the fish when it's swimming forward. Yes, it will go like that, but when it's not swimming, it's just drifting. And fish do that, they drift a lot to sense the environment. What is the water actually flowing? So first of all, what if the fish is in the middle, it's drifting, and there is no gradient? What's the water flow over its body?
Zero.
No water is flowing, none. So he can't know, right? There's no clue. But what if it's at the edge where there's a gradient? And sort of that's the last true insight we have. It's not that water washes over the fish. That's the wrong intuition that everybody has, right? That if you're a fish in a river, that water will flow over the fish like that. That is not the case, because the fish is drifting with the water.
Yeah. Your belly gets bent, I guess.
It gets actually, yes, there's a rotational flow, right? And that is, that is because the fish is moving to the left with a certain velocity. Up here, the water is not moving at all, so the fish is overtaking the water. It's swimming faster than the water here, so we get a net rightward flow over its nose. Yes? So water is moving rightward over the snout of the fish. On the tail region, water is moving faster because of the gradient than the fish. It's overtaking the fish, so there's a net velocity vector to the left. So what this means, what the fish is experiencing, is a curl. It's like it's in an eddy. And it's not a fish, any object. You can read this in a physics textbook. Any object that you put into a gradient of water flow will start to spin. And it's going to start spinning clockwise up here and counterclockwise down here. So there's a rotational water flow, and the chirality of the water flow actually tells you, in this case, whether you're facing the wall or whether you're facing away from the wall, which will be very, very important in the next slide, I think, or so. So that's how a fish can know whether it's in a river or in a lake. It can't know which way the river is flowing yet. So which way does the fish have to turn in this case to do rheotaxis, positive rheotaxis? Left or right?
Right.
Right. Yes. He wants to swim against the current, so he has to turn right here. So rightward motion is the correct. So that's what he's sensing. And the fish has to turn right, always, in this case. The problem is, up here, rightward means following the rotation of the flow. Down here, it means it has to go against the rotation of the flow. Is that clear? So the fish, it's not as easy as just measure the spinning and then just follow or go against it, because this is sort of not yet, it's a degenerate problem. There's two solutions and only one equation, so he can't solve that. So he needs another equation, the fish. And what he's doing, he's sensing the flow, and then he's making a swim bout, and then he's sensing it again. That's what we show. Well, that's actually the only way how he can do it at all. And again, pure deduction. So in this case, the gradient decreases, the curl decreases, and then it should go against the flow. And in this case, the gradient increases, and here it should follow the flow, right? So that's the simplest algorithm that the fish can use, simplest symmetric algorithm, to do rheotaxis. And it should only work in the area where there is actually a gradient. So here's the algorithm, Mach level 2. Now finally, we've reached Mach level 2. Measure the curl, swim, measure curl again. That's what you do, that's the input, the nature of the input. If the curl, it sounds like an algorithm, no? If then, yes, sir. If the curl increases, then make turn in direction of curl. If curl decreases, then make turn against direction of curl. That's it. That's the algorithm. It sounds complicated, it is complicated, but it's the simplest way how any animal can do rheotaxis in the darkness. So this is an algorithm that you can never ever get to when you start at the mechanistic level, this at Mahr level 3, but we'll get to that in my final slides. Yes?
So the elongated form of the fish would also predict that this response should be much stronger if it starts out in such a position than if it starts out in such a position.
We'll get to that. The problem is, if it's like that, the line integral around the body actually gets you the same value because you have a much longer projection of the flow onto the lateral line. So much more water flows now. In this case, no water flows over the long axis of the fish. All the water flows at high speed over the snout and the tail. If you rotate the fish around, then you get a low flow, but over a much larger area. I'll get to that in a minute. Stokes theory, which they solve this. But first of all, when we check whether the algorithm is actually true by doing a bout-by-bout analysis of all fish, so what you see here is usually on the x-axis is turn magnitude, how much fish turn. Sometimes they turn left, sometimes right, but mostly they swim forward. Yes, it's a probability distribution. And only when the gradient increases, they suddenly make large angle turns, which they otherwise wouldn't do, but only following the minute curl, right? So that's what they do. What's conspicuously missing is this other bump here, yes, against the rotation. So apparently the algorithm is even simpler that they implement. If curl increases, then make turn in direction of the curl. If curl decreases, make turn. Well, that's not what they do. Otherwise, just swim straight. Yes. There's a typo here, right? Yes. Otherwise, just swim straight. Ignore that, right? And so that's what they do. And then we can ask how large is actually the turn magnitude depending on the delta gradient, on this change in curl that they experience. And what we can see here is that if the delta gradient is small, they just swim straight. So this is equally distributed. Only if the delta gradient passes a certain threshold value do they make these turns. So they have to be away, they have to be within the boundary layer, they have to experience a large change, only then will they do rheotaxis. So this tells you already that they won't do it in the middle of the tube. And that's something you can easily simulate, right? You can implement this now with a very simple random walk algorithm. So this is a particle random walking, drawing angles from this distribution that we've measured. And if we add this little bump, yes, gradient-dependent bump, then you can see the particle will actually implement this rule, and it looks identical like a larval zebrafish doing rheotaxis. 5 more minutes. I won't need the 5 minutes. I'll briefly tell you about now the neural implementation. So we've solved Mahr level 1 and Mahr level 2. The algorithm is known. And now I'll briefly tell you how once you have a solid theory about the algorithm, how it's dead easy to get at the implementation. So that's the last part, last few minutes of my talk. And first of all, an introduction to the hair cells that stick out, same as the hair cells you have in your inner ear. And one thing you'll see already is they come in two flavors. In tailward projecting, tail activated, water flowing towards the tail and water flowing towards the head. They come in two polarities, the hair cells. They're also nicely aligned along the body axis, the posterior lateral line, right? Looks like that. And you'll realize instantly that this is perfectly suited for a curl detection. Because then, if you want to detect the curl, rotational flow, you need similar amount of similar sensitivity for backward and for forward flow in both directions to have a curl detector. And so that's our theory now, that they have a curl detector, yes, strong curl, weak curl, and you see already the hair cells go in opposite directions. In this case, it's clockwise curl. And in a way, that's kind of a cute mathematical side note is Stokes' theorem states that if you want to know the net curl of the volume that you're replacing, you need to do a line integral around the circumference. It's the lateral line integral, and that's exactly what fish are doing. They're integrating the flow around their lateral line, around the circumference, to calculate the curl of the water volume that they're replacing. So they know all about Stokes' theorem and they can solve it, right? That the, now, in terms of Mach level 3, how would you implement that? The curl detector. Again, this is my final PowerPoint presentation here, is you need head to tail hair cells are activated on one side, the different polarity, tail to head on the other side, and they need to combine to get integrated in a central neuron here, which I call the clockwise curl detector. And at the same time, I postulate that there are inhibitory neurons that inhibit the anticlockwise, the counterclockwise curl detector. So this is the neural implementation. In a way, we haven't done the experiments yet. It turns out, fortunately, it wasn't really necessary to get this published, because it has to be true. It could be implemented, you know. It doesn't have to be implemented in that way, but some form of that has to be true, because the fish, we know it has a curl detector, yes. And we know he has two, a clockwise and an anticlockwise one. So this would be the anticlockwise curl detector. And again, that's going to be another paper and another project, but it's fun, and we know already what the outcome is. It's more descriptive rather than explanatory. But it's a fun project. I think it's not really truly relevant. Why I need the inhibitory neurons is that when the fish is swimming forward, then there's flow backwards towards the tail, then none of these curl detectors should be activated. Yes. And with that, since we've solved also Mach level 3, without having to do any experiments, right? We still have to do them to make sure what the true implementation is, but I don't think, and maybe that's the whole point, there is no insight, no true insight. There's maybe an interesting aspect of how neurons in a larval tiger fish implement the algorithm, but how they do rheotaxis, I would argue we have solved. We know how they do rheotaxis, yes sir. How it's the algorithm, we know the algorithm. How they actually implement it is still interesting, but I think in terms of steps of discovery, I would say this, the algorithm, is the true insight. How you implement it now is more of the nuts and bolts and the details, still interesting, but it doesn't leave you with such a profound satisfaction of having figured out how the fish actually does it. And maybe it's a last remark before I end and take a few more questions. If you would start with Mach level 3, yeah, if you just do whole brain imaging and whole brain connectomics in a larval zebrafish, you would find a circuit like that, but it would make no sense whatsoever. Because why would you have to hook up one polarity? It's one cell type. Yeah? We would find that head to tail, one polarity. There's a neuron that gets input from one polarity and also gets input from another polarity exclusively. Why does this make any sense? So I think people would be puzzled and move on. Maybe as a side note in the discussion, maybe as an eddy detector, like a toilet sink detector, right? If the fish gets flushed down a toilet or whatever, it's very difficult to come up with an explanation that makes any sense if you don't come from Mach level 2 and Mach level 1. And maybe that's my final message to all of you. Yes, sir. Don't get carried away with the implementation, with collecting the data, with the sequencing, with all of that. Step back and ask what are the algorithms? What's being computed and why? Thank you very much.
Did you also create this current artificially? For example, if fish were living in air, we could kind of blow air over them in certain directions. So could you use fine needles to create the appearance of such a curl?
Yes, very good. So how would you, so in free swimming fish, that's basically what you do when you have them in a small tube with gradients. Because then the curl is actually generated by the gradient profile. And since the fish explore it, they will be exposed to different rotational flows simply by virtue of the swimming in this gradient profile. Your question is, what if we head fix the fish, yes, and there is no flow? This is actually a question that almost all graduate students and faculty, not just graduate students, senior faculty fail at. How do you simulate flow or wind for a tethered animal? A tethered animal that's either swimming freely or flying freely. Yes. And almost everyone in the world, all people studying flow, anemotaxis and rheotaxis, the way they simulate flow is by blowing water into the face of the animal, or blowing wind into the face of Drosophila, if you want to simulate wind in a free-flying animal. this is not how you simulate wind at all because of Galileo. Yes, sir. So your question is, in a head-fixed fish, what would be the appropriate simulation of a flow gradient? You could, or actually what you do, you have to, what Alex was saying, you have to generate a rotational flow field, a tiny rotational flow field around the fish, and what you would do is you would blow a little bit of water tailward on the left side and snoutward on the right side. Yes, and that's something we are building right now. In a tail-free preparation, that's harder because the fish will knock the pipettes out of the way. Yes, but there are ways to overcome that. Yes, we need to do that in order to do these whole brain imaging experiments now, where we want to now simulate water flow to a fish that's, this would be in darkness. How, this is a question for everybody, how do you simulate water flow, say to a fly, Drosophila, that's flying now, a tethered Drosophila, and you want to simulate wind. And I can tell you already what's the wrong answer. It is you have a fan that blows wind into the face of the fly, and that's because once the fly is airborne, it's in the reference frame of the wind, and there is no relative motion anymore, none. If you go up in a hot air balloon on a windy day, once you're airborne, there's zero wind. Is this clear? This should be clear now. This is the most important message of my whole talk, right? If you go up on a hot air balloon on a windy day, once you're airborne, you will feel zero wind. You can light a cigarette, you can have a candle, there's going to be no wind whatsoever. How do you know that there's wind? How you can you measure wind speed and direction in the hot air balloon? Anyone? Yes? Turbulences? What if it's laminar, jet stream? You do what?
Check the ground.
If the ground is moving, then you know, and you can even tell which way the wind is going and how fast, if you know your elevation above the ground, right? So how do you simulate wind in a flying Drosophila? You move the ground, yes, you move the ground. You don't put a fan that blows wind into the face, because there is the only time you blow wind into the face of Drosophila is when it's trying to fly forward. Yes. This was your point, right? Your self-generated motion is something that you should maybe simulate. So in our case, we would only blow water into the face of the fish when it's making a swim, right? Mm-hmm.
So in her experimental setup, the largest diameter of the tube was like
4 centimeters.
So just like more like a theoretical question, but
yes.
At the very beginning, when you think about why the fish does that, it's also why, where, for what did it?
What's
evolve,
the point?
Right? So fish probably don't live in 2 centimeter tubes.
Larval zebra fish, or not in tubes, but in shallow, small, densely vegetated. So the rice paddies in India, yes, sir. The closest object is usually less than 2 centimeters away. If that's your question, right?
Yeah.
Even if you think about reef, coral reefs, right? Mm-hmm. With water flowing over the reef. The question is not the diameter of the tube, the question, what's the distance to the closest stationary object?
Okay, but along that line,
I was
wondering, like, this setup here is a very, has a very kind of like non-complicated gradient landscape, right?
Artificial.
I would imagine that in this kind of shallow water, the turbulences are super complicated as compared to that.
Ah, yes, so I didn't have this here. So what we had to do for one of the referees, this is actually a very common question, what if you add turbulence? Yes, does it still work when you add turbulence into our tubes? And the real question, I think, is not so much, so the experiment to do is not to add turbulence to the tube and ask, can fish still do it? Because you'll see they do it worse. The question is really in the simulation. Yes. Once we add turbulence to our simulation, under what conditions do fish still? So real taxis will degrade, but it degrades gracefully. So the more vortices you and Karman streets you introduce, the less well they do it. And then there are interesting non-linear aspects of, if it's fully turbulent, it breaks down. But the density of eddies, the strength of eddies, they have interesting aspects on this algorithm. But these are questions you can answer just by doing simulations. And also, of course, by looking at naturally occurring turbulences in slowly moving streams. Yes, yeah. And it turns out that as long as the water is not moving rapidly enough, so if you're not looking in rapids, white water rapids, right, under normal flow conditions, it's lamina enough that you don't run into catastrophic problems. Mm-hmm. But it can be quantified, and we had to do it, and it's in the supplementary information.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, I'm sure you have heard of the dot assay that was used and set up by Heavy Fire, where fish, zebra fish are placed in a racetrack in a little bit of water that is translucent on top of a monitor that's facing upward, and little dots go over the monitor. This is being used to look at if these fish approach or avoid these dots, depending how big they are. But do these studies actually also take into account that that reference frame also may affect their reflexes?
But they don't. I think one thing we are trying to do now is use these racetracks. And there was a question previously, what if they're conflicting stimuli? Yes.
Exactly.
If you have moving dot, big dots, which they run away from, small dots that come, then you have a reotaxis problem, an octomotor problem that they will generally follow whole field motion. You can also add now looming stimuli into that, which is sort of more the big dots. But you can now also stream water through these racetracks and see under which conditions fish will follow which aspect. In the Bayer assay, where they have large and small dots drifting under the lines, and there is a rheotaxis issue in here, namely it's all a little bit contaminated by the fish wanting to do rheotaxis and trying to follow the general flow, go against the water. I think you can orthogonalize that, right? And that's what Herwig very elegantly did, right? And he said, independent of the optomotor component, there is still a differentiation between the big dots, they're running away from those, and they're approaching the small ones. And you can even tell that if the fish is hungry, this shifts this balance. So you can, you have to take it into consideration, but I think it's not at all a real problem. Yes?
I have two questions. One is, in the letter line, if I'm not mistaken, has this villain synopsis, which in the eye get disassembled during the night. Can you comment on this in context of your essay? And the second question is, how does the age of the fish that you were using in your experiment correlate with the maturation of the letter line?
Okay, so the
first question, did everybody get it?
Well, I repeat, the first question is in the eye. That is one of my colleagues at Harvard, John Dowling, found that the ribbon synapses in the eye get disassembled actually in the evening, and then the eye is dysfunctional during the night, and then it gets reassembled like an hour before the sun goes up. That's a really amazing finding, and the MAR level one would be, what's the point of that? And I think it's because fish don't have eyelids, so they can't close them. That was one explanation. The other one is energy conservation, that the dark current in photoreceptors actually produces a lot of, anyway. The lateral line doesn't do that. That was here. Does it also happen in the lateral line? No, it doesn't. It stays active during the night. Maybe it's even important, right? If it's a dark adapted thing, then it shouldn't really. I mean, if the one other aspect of that, during darkness, when it, during the night, fish actually don't do rheotaxis. What they do, they glue themselves to leaves or rocks. So that's their trick of not getting swept away while they sleep, and I think they do sleep. They just glue them, they go to bed, right? They go and stick themselves to a rock such that they don't get swept away. So they could, in principle, even afford to get rid of the lateral line. But just to be safe, if the glue doesn't hold, right, it might be a good idea to keep it. The other question was... Oh yes, how does the maturation of the lateral line correlate with the age of the fish? And the lateral line is one of the things that actually comes online very, very early, along with the ganglion cells of the retina. So this is fully mature around 3 days or 4 days after fertilization, before hatching, before they actually come out of the egg. So that is sort of, by the time they hatch, it's fully mature. It also regenerates very, very quickly. So that's actually important for us for head fixed behavior, because if you embed the fish in agarose, in cello, you remove the agarose, you rip out all the cupulas of the lateral line. But what you have to do is just wait 8 hours and then they regrow. Right? So that it is fully functional and it is mature and it also can regenerate very quickly.
So your circuit level mechanism that you predict is under the assumption that rheotaxis is the only problem with the lateral line.
No.
And I think this is a general problem, that how you put this framework, because usually nervous system has to solve many problems maybe at the same time. So
well,
I assume maybe the mechanism will be different because the other function of the lateral line.
Well, so maybe if that was the message, then I have to recant. I have to officially renounce that. I don't think that the role of the lateral line is only for rheotaxis. I think this is one submodule that we see here that has been specifically evolved for the purpose of real, this curl detector here, right? I think that's a very specific submodule. Those neurons, the afferent neurons from the hair cells, protect everywhere. Yes. They serve many, many purposes. One is to avoid predation, suction feeding predators. Another one to run away if you get touched. One probably even for finding the rock. So the lateral line goes to many, many places and it serves many, many purposes. But there is a submodule. Yes, this one here, the curl detector, which we believe has specifically evolved for the purpose of neotaxis.
But how do you know that it's an isolated submodule that can be integrated with other modules serving other functions?
Well, so this is integrated in all other functions because that just relays the information from the hair cells. This is, I mean, we don't even know this exists. This has to exist somewhere. Right? We haven't even measured that. But that is a curl detector, right? That measures only when there's a very tiny rotational flow around the fish's body. Maybe there are other useful instances for that, and that might very well be the case, but the most parsimonious explanation is this is being used to detect curl, to detect the gradient in the water. Right? So you're right, I mean, there could be other, but I think there's sort of a tree of specialization, and the more specialized you get, the more likely it is that this particular submodule has been put in by evolution for this particular purpose.
It's even complicated problem. Yeah? If you look at a very complicated circuit serving multiple functions, you even don't know how to isolate individual modules.
Here. That's right. And that's, I think, I mean, that's right. But I think that's where MAR level 2 becomes so important, that you know already what the computation is. Otherwise, you're completely out at sea. You're lost. Right? If you do whole brain imaging in a fish like that, you would never ever find this, because what Manuel said already, the whole brain lights up when the fish does rheotaxis. All of these neurons are active. And you wouldn't have any chance of making sense of it, right? You have to go in already with a specific hypothesis.
If I understood well, the acceleration shouldn't have an effect on the fish because it's the same density as the water. Right?
Yes.
Might there be any clue from the body when we have the phylogenetics like some part of the future?
Yes. So the question is, what about acceleration and density? During my talk, I briefly said that there's only no water flow over the body of the fish during an acceleration if the density of the fish is exactly the same density as the surrounding water. What if it's not? And it never is, and it turns out actually fish are slightly denser than the surrounding waters. You don't even need inhomogeneities across the body. The whole body actually will, when you accelerate the whole thing, get dragged a little bit backwards. Yes. But because the water is slightly faster than the fish. It's a minute difference. The density of a fish is about 1.001. So there's a small effect. Why we don't believe they use that? Because the fish actually has an oscillate in the inner ear that has a density of 2.8. Whenever the fish gets accelerated, this oscillate serves like a very, very strong inhomogeneity, yes. It's a very dense object that's being ripped backwards whenever the fish gets accelerated, and it bends a bunch of hair cells that are dedicated for this purpose. So the fish has already a perfect module in its place to detect acceleration, yes, which is much, much more sensitive. Actually, you can quantify it. It's 2,400 times more sensitive than the hair cells sticking out of the body, which would have to use a density difference of 0.1%, yes. Whereas the otolith in the inner ear is an inhomogeneity that has a density difference of 240%. And that's why we don't think that acceleration measured by the hair cells plays any role. If fish would do that, they would be utterly, utterly stupid, right? And I don't believe in intelligent design, but I don't think that evolution is that stupid, right? That they would ignore an extremely sensitive accelerometer that they have in their ear at the expense of a really, really shitty sort of accelerometer that they have sticking out of into the water. Yes. Wait, there was another question, yes? Well, it's not a sphere. I mean, we are physicists, so we like to assume that everything is a sphere, right? So to consider a cow, assume it's a sphere. As long as the fish is drifting and not moving, it doesn't matter what shape, like a tree with many branches that's drifting in the Mississippi, yes, there is no, the shape doesn't matter because you're in the same velocity frame as the surrounding water. The shape is completely irrelevant unless you start moving actively. Yeah. Once you want to move actively, that's when the shape of the fish becomes really important. That's what George Lauder studies, is the biophysics of a fish moving actively through the water. But I think that's a completely different story.
One last question.
Yes.
Simple models are great. And therefore, I think it will work. Mm-hmm. But when I think of an animal, then it's able to compensate in a very good and quick measure. And therefore, could it be that it uses really a bunch of combination? It's like it's also using the ear. It's also using his density and the constant flow, and it's of course using this and further on. Perhaps there's still more stuff and it could all be connected for the decision. So then there would not be only this one turn neuron, there would be a bunch of neurons where all this stuff get together.
So there's two questions I think here. One, what about multimodal integration? And one about integration per se, right? Is this just one neuron that's sensing something, feed forward, output, and we're done? Maybe the second question first. We don't think it's a single neuron. What we actually believe the fish is doing spatial and temporal integration during the 1 second between swim bouts. So one thing I haven't said is fish swim in discrete bouts, which last about 100 milliseconds. And then because the Reynolds number is so small, they will instantly come to a stop and assume the velocity of the water. They don't drift, they don't coast like a supertanker. So a fish is more like a tiny particle rather than a supertanker, they don't coast. Yeah. So that means that during this interval, which lasts a second, 10 times longer than the bout period, why do they do that? Mar level one, it's a very inefficient way of swimming fast because they rest for 10 times longer than they actually swim. So this is not a good way to get from A to B. So the question is, why do they do that, right? Why did evolution implement that? And we believe they spent this time sensing. These 900 milliseconds, they're sensing. And what they're sensing here, they're doing both. They're doing a spatial integration from all of these that probably all average together onto one or many. Yes, there's a sort of collective integration. That's another hypothesis that we haven't really elaborated upon here. So there is spatial integration going on. That's what we expect to see. Many of these curl detectors that integrate, but there's also temporal integration. During these 800 milliseconds, there's noise, there's a lot of noise in the curl, and what we believe is there's a temporal integration, almost like a diffusion model, until it reaches threshold and the fish initiates the next swim, right? So both of these aspects we believe are present, so it's not quite as simple as I've painted it here, but in principle, that's the core algorithm that we think is used, and on top of that, you have evidence accumulation and even decision making, right, left or right, which is done by integration. The second question is, what about all these other senses, like acceleration, inner ear, eye? So one thing that we know already is the eye. The eye also drives the downstream turn neurons much, much stronger than these wimpy curl detectors here, right? So that's an interesting question. If the fish turns left, especially if we give conflicting information, if there's stripes moving to the right and a looming stimulus coming from here and a prey object over there, all on top of water flowing in one direction, what's the fish going to do? Yes. And I think that question is best answered at the behavioral level, right? You would first do a quantitative study of the behavior and then make a model like that. And at the very end, you're allowed, my grad students are allowed to peek into the brain and see whether the neural correlates that they see are actually related to the model that they made. And once they've done that, then they're allowed to take the fish and do a connectomics approach and confirm it, constrain the model further, verify it with connectome, right, with the circuit diagram. And at the very end, I hope I have this here. Oh, I have to show you that. This is the perfect final slide. What are they going to do at the very end? Talking about optogenetics, yes. At the very end, once you know already everything, then if you really have to, you put channel rhodopsin into your neuron and you stimulate it and you make sure that it all makes sense. Thank you.
Thank you.